Good evening, everybody. My name is Nan Chase. I live in Asheville, and I've been a gardener here in Western North Carolina for 35 years, and I'd like to share some of the skills necessary to can your harvest, to preserve your harvest with canning. It's safe, it's easy, it's very rewarding, it's delicious, and especially in the middle of winter when you don't feel like going out, all you have to do is reach into the cupboard and you've got something that's already there. Just by way of background, I'm the author of Eat Your Yard, which is about edible landscape design and has about 35 or 40 recipes, including some canning recipes. I'm also the co-author of Drink the Harvest, which came out in 2014 with Denise Guest as the other co-author. And this is really about harnessing the beverage power of your garden or the farmer's market, wherever you like to get your fresh produce. And this has got about 40 recipes, original recipes, and this has got step-by-step how-to in case you don't remember every single detail tonight and you happen to want the book. Everybody's got a handout. Everybody's got a packet of a pickle mix, whether you like pickles or not, that's what you got tonight. And we'll talk a little bit about why that's a great starting point. Everybody seems to have a head of garlic, so you can hold on to that, and we'll talk in the second half of the presentation about how to put all these things together. Give me a little bit of information. Raise your hand, please, if you have done any canning before. Okay, great. If you've never done any canning at all, I'm going to address the people who really, all of you together, because there are always tips that you can learn, and I always can pick up new tips from you, people who've got some canning experience. But I'm going to start with the basics. You all have a handout, and what I'd like to do is to just come back to this in a few minutes, but I want to give you the why to on canning and show you some of the things I do in a typical year. This is what I call meal ready to eat. This is actually a tomato sauce. I live on a very, very tiny, less than 1/10 of an acre plot in downtown Asheville. So I choose not to spend my precious yard space on growing the tomatoes, but I grow herbs, I grow garlic, I grow greens, I grow onions, the type of thing that go into this and enrich it. So what I do a lot of times is I will take the bounty of the farms around me and then add to it from my own garden. So it's not as though you have to grow every single thing that you can. You can take advantage of things that your neighbors give you, things that you get at the farmer's market, and in some cases, things you might be able to pick from the street side, because there's some really great food sources in our street trees and landscape plants. This one, and I'll describe the labeling a little bit more, but everything's marked on the top. So in case I forget about why I have a Sharpie, it's very important to label all your produce as to the year and the contents, because after a little bit, you're going to see, oops, which one is this? What year did I make this? What's the product? This is from this year, and it's marked SR2. It's the second batch of strawberry rhubarb. So I don't have a lot of room to grow my own strawberries. I get those at the farmer's market, but I do grow some great rhubarb. Strawberry and rhubarb together make a fantastic juice. This is a very, very little sugar added. It's got a delicious fresh flavor. It's fairly thick. And I will go ahead in season, in the spring is when I make this, and can up the juice. It's there. If I feel like boiling it down later to make a syrup, I can do that. I have lots and lots of it, so I can make popsicles out of it for the grandkids. I can open up a couple of these cans in the winter or the fall when I've got time and make wine, and strawberry wine is really one of the best garden wines that I've tried. So this is a strawberry rhubarb, and you can see the beautiful color. It tastes like you're eating a strawberry, you're just drinking strawberry juice, it's wonderful, which is what it is. All the steps are gonna be in Drink the Harvest. This is a scavenged or foraged product. This is service, pure service berry juice. You see service berries all over this region as a landscape plant. Well, they set tons and tons of berries in June. They're also called June berries. And we go out across the street to a bank parking lot and take as many berries as we can get off the birds and process it into juice and have it for use all year. Now, look at this. This is a vacuum seal, and we're going to be talking about the process, why canning is good. There's no ring on this. It is a vacuum seal. And the water bath, and we'll be going over that process, does two things. It sterilizes the content so that it can't get any mold or fuzzy spores, anything you don't want. It can't spoil. Also, that process creates a vacuum seal. We're going to force the oxygen out during the cooking process. When it cools, it pulls this top down, and so you have a seal, and that's what makes it shelf stable. So all of these, notice we're not going to have the rings on. There's one exception. Once they're processed, the ring's going to come off and you can store it. Last year and again this year, right around my house, I've got grapes all on my porch and grapes and grapes and grapes and grapes. So last year I had about three different batches of grapes, and this is called Grape 15. This is from 2015. Wonderful, rich, grapey flavor. It's pure grape juice, so you can cut it with soda. You can put it into an alcoholic drink. You can make it into wine. You can make it into jam. But this freezes, in effect, or stops any spoilage as the year goes on. I'll come back to this one. This is one I made a couple of years ago. Just wanted to show you, if you get a big harvest of hot peppers, you can pickle those. This is a pickle, and you'll see the water level, it's actually vinegar, looks as though it's gone down. I think what happened during process is it went up into the peppers. So I think the right amount of beverage, it's still sealed, and there's nothing wrong with it, but there's a little bit of variation there. Again, we're going to talk about pickles more than once here. This is just a plain dill pickle, started with that packet you've got, cucumbers from the farmer's market, and these don't have a lot of time left on them, but I've been using these for demonstration. Now this one does have a ring on it. I was just feeling a little lazy last week, and it actually sealed by itself, but I'm keeping this in the refrigerator because I didn't run it through the bath. But this is a new recipe that just came out in Saveur magazine, watermelon rind pickle. It's delicious. It's a sweet and sour syrup, vinegar, sugar, lots of spices, and I grew the coriander seeds myself. So a lot of things you can do with herbs from your garden, incorporating them into your canned goods. So that's a little tour of some of the canned things that can come out of the garden. So what you've got in your yard, or what you like to eat, or what you like to have, there is on page 4 a little worksheet, and take that home and sort of name your favorite and your best crops, and that's a good starting point for you. Now, before I go on to page 1 of the handout, anybody here a little bit concerned that canning is dangerous? You might get botulism and poison your family. Nobody? Okay, usually there's somebody, and I used to feel that way too. Okay, if you're not going to admit it, that's fine. I just want to tell you that it's not an issue. This is very, very safe. We're talking about high acid foods. Botulism only grows in a low acid, air-free environment, and it's mostly a danger, and it's not really even a danger today, with root crops. It is a soil-borne pathogen. It used to be more problem. You can go and search online. The latest outbreak was in the Arctic Circle from bad whale meat. Seriously. So it's not really an issue, but just feel very safe that as long as you're on the high acid or pickle family, the pathogen cannot grow. So these are things I feed my family, I feed the grandchildren, and that's enough for me. It's very important when you're canning to realize that you can't remember all the little details at once. And in fact, every year I go back and I consult reference works as I get going, because I need to either check how long to boil it, how much space to leave, what the proportion of the contents are, etc. So I first of all put some reference points for you on page 1 of the handout. The National Center for Home Food Preservation is a government-funded service from the Department of Agriculture, and that is really your go-to source for the latest science-driven research. If you have any questions, it's an excellent site. Same thing with the Cooperative Extension System, county offices. Every county in the country at least used to have a county extension agent, and those are people who can help you with either classes or individual questions, and they supervise the Master Gardener program. So they're also a government service. We've paid for it. They can come and give you any skills you need. So do feel free, and that will identify where your county offices are, that website. Next is the Blue Book Guide to Preserving, and this really is called the Bible of canning. This is going to give you all the scientific safety information, some recipes, And in fact, when Denise Guest and I were working on Drink the Harvest, we went to the agricultural extension people so that we could check our science. And they said, oh, we just checked the blue book. So everybody right down to the ag extension agent uses the blue book, and you can find it often at the grocery store, at the hardware store, anywhere that canning supplies are sold. So don't feel as though you have to memorize everything and keep it sticking in your mind. That's hard to do. Ball products, there's a very excellent website at freshpreserving.com, so you can actually order all your supplies online and not have to go around and drive and get them. So that's a really nice service. They've got a blog, and you can talk to other people doing canning projects. Dehydrators, why in the world would we want a dehydrator for canning? Well, if you grow herbs, the herbs may come in at a different time than the vegetables or the fruits that you're using. So dehydrating is a way of preserving some of the components until everything is all put together and you can use it. And I love the dehydrator because it's so simple, very inexpensive to run. It's safe around children. It's just a great way to preserve herbs, seeds, lemon peels, citrus peels, anything that you might want to use later in the season. You don't want to can it, go ahead and dehydrate it. Sometimes in connection with a dehydrator, you might want to really extend shelf life, and some people use a vacuum sealer. And I have not had the greatest luck with that, but I did want to put that information down there for you. Layman's is an online emporium of high-quality canning equipment, Crocs for fermentation, food mills, cider presses, they've got it all. And I've used their materials for years and years, and very high quality and a great website. And they've got a big catalog too. Plants, you're kind of on your own. You probably know where to find your plants. And garden club, that's just a fun suggestion. It's a way to not necessarily go out to lunch with other ladies who lunch, but it is a way to learn more about gardening and food production and so forth. So what I'd like to do next is really take some time and go over the basic equipment. And you'll see the basic rules for canning, and we'll get to all those as we go through the presentation. As long as you follow the directions, really, if you can boil water or if you can turn on a dishwasher, you can can safely. That's about all you need to know. All right, the jars. Here is what you are not ever going to use for canning. You're not ever going to recycle a food jar. And the reason is these are made and manufactured to be used once. The walls are thinner, the threads are narrower, the tops are not meant to be resealed, they are not guaranteed for safety, and you're not ever going to use a recycled food jar. So we're just going to... ever. Okay, now standard canning jars are called mason jars. And they may be made by Ball, they may be named Kerr, but the type of jar is called a mason jar. Don't ask me why. And I'd like to run through the sizes, large to small, and tell you some of the advantages and disadvantages. This is about the biggest one. You can occasionally find a gallon, but this is a half gallon. I don't really even can much anymore. My kids are out of the house. I don't have a big cider press. But these are great while you're in the process of making your juices or making your contents, because you can store them in the fridge, see what's inside, and you know exactly what the quantity is. So if you want to break it down to smaller quantities. The other problem with this size jar is that you'll see it really is taller than the pot, than our water bath. And for proper sealing, you need to have an inch of water over the top of the jar. So if you use these great big jars, you're going to have to get a bigger water bath. The other thing is, unless you have a large group of people, once you open a half gallon quantity, you've kind of got to go ahead and drink it up or use that up. So these are great for intermediate steps, but I don't recommend it for your everyday needs. Next, we have quarts. And there are two sizes of quarts. These are very useful. There's a narrow mouth and a wide mouth. All jars are going to be either narrow mouth or wide mouth, and they're all going to have either a small or a large band that fits on top. So all the small mouth are going to have the same, use the same equipment for the small. All the big ones are going to have the same for the big. So these are quarts. They're really nice for family size quantities. Now the difference in usage is anything that's chunky, pieces of fruit, a thick sauce, anything like that, I would suggest you use a wide mouth because it's easier to get the contents in and to keep the air bubbles out, and it's easier to get things out. If you're just doing juices and liquids, this is perfectly fine, the narrow mouth. But for overall, if you had to choose between a box of one or a box of the other, I'm always going to go with the wide mouth. This is one of my favorite sizes. This is hard to find. It's a pint and a half, so it's halfway in between a pint. It uses a wide mouth, and I just, for two people, it's a really good size for that quantity. You don't see them very often. Next, you have pint, and these are really handy, but they take up more storage space, so you have to consider what space. They've got a narrow pint, narrow mouth, and a wide mouth. Same thing, for just plain liquids, this is fine, but if you're doing a pickle product, anything in chunks, it's easier to work with it, and it's easier to clean with the wide mouth. So if I had to choose between narrow and wide mouth, I'd go with the wide mouth. Next, there are a number of other little intermediate sizes. This is a half pint, and these are nice for gift sizes, for sample sizes, for if you have a little bit left over, if it's just, you know, a specialty item, a jelly, a jam, something like that. I usually use just the quarts and the pints, but that's a half pint. And then you've got this little bitty one, which is about, I think it's a half a cup or a quarter of a cup. Again, for a gift and sample sizes and certain things, that's a nice size. And these are going to be a narrow mouth. Okay, those are the jars. Now, the lids and bands are these. These are the bands, and these are only used during the water bath process. Once they've sealed, you take these off. These can be used over and over until they start to get rusty or dinged up. Then you toss them, and you can buy just replacements of the bands or the lids. The lids have got to be new every time you do a batch of canning because they have a little rubber seal, and once that's been sealed, it won't seal again properly. There are reusable lids. I haven't really used them because I learned how to do it this way, so it's hard to suddenly change, but you can certainly look into those reusable lids. So you're going to buy these once, and generally a flat of 12 is going to be about $10. You can use these for 5, 10, 15 years until they get chipped, but these are something that are going to last and last and last for you. These might go for a couple of seasons, and again, the lids themselves, very cheap, but you got to replace those every time you do a batch or reuse the glass. So that's the jars. And again, I just use a Sharpie. You can get labels, you can make fancy labels. They tend to stick to the jars. They look icky and it's a mess and the dissolvable ones are horrible. So I just use a Sharpie on the lid. As soon as I'm done, I just put the year and the contents. Now, there's another set of equipment. Here are the basic other pieces that you really need. The number one is a wide mouth funnel. Because everything you put into these jars, this will fit either the wide mouth or the narrow. So you can see we don't have a huge investment in equipment. Once you get the equipment, you have it. You can buy a kit that's got all the basics too. So look at that Fresh Preserving website because that's sometimes economical. So this is stainless steel. You can get them in plastic. I like the stainless steel. That's the wide mouth funnel. The other really important piece of equipment is a wide tong. This is going to be lifting jars in and out of boiling water. Regular tong won't do it. I do have a regular size tong for lifting lids out, and I'll get to that in just a second. So I've got two sets of tongs. Have a rubber spatula. Occasionally you might want to run that through. It's just handy to have one of these for the production process. These are kitchen scissors, kind of a heavy-duty cutting scissor, and for getting your fruit, your vegetables, everything cleaned out, your herbs, these are really nice to have. For making the berry juices and things, I have a potato masher. Some people like to use an inversion, what do you call it, a submersible?
Immersion blender.
This is my immersion blender. But for the berries and that type of thing, I use this to help break apart the fibers. I've got a stainless steel ladle, and you're going to be pouring things into from the pan into the jar, and stainless steel, a cooking spoon for while you're cooking. Notice I keep saying stainless steel or a non-reactive plastic. If you use aluminum, you're gonna really mess everything up. That will react with the acid. It will turn things a bad color, bad flavor. It won't poison you, but it's just gonna be unattractive. So everything's gonna be touching either enamel or stainless steel or glass. There's an exception, I'll tell you about that. So you notice there's a saucepan here. While things are getting prepared, it's important to have all your utensils at least scalded. Everything has to be germ-free. You have to pretend as though that you are the health department and you're coming to inspect your own place. You're gonna have all your surfaces very clean, lift up the little plug on your sink and clean out the grungy stuff underneath there, that we all have that problem. Meanwhile, while I'm working on the stove at the process, I'm gonna keep everything that I need in a saucepan and add, not boiling, but scalding water. Scalding's gonna be a 190. I'm also gonna have a bowl or a saucepan to put the lids and the bands. Everything in this process is going to be sterilized. It doesn't have to be sterilized at pressure cooker temperatures, but it's just gotta kill the germs. Generally, scalding is good. And in fact, you don't really wanna boil these by themselves. Okay. So those are the little bits of equipment that we've got. This is an actual tea kettle, but I'm just pretending that I'm gonna use it. A couple of other things, a measuring, like a quart measuring implement here. This is Pyrex, that's perfect. Really helps if you have, say, a big batch of something going in. Also, it's just handy if you're measuring sugar, you're measuring lemon juice, something like that. So that's good to have. And this is an innovation that we came up with after Drink the Harvest came out, unfortunately, which is instead of cheesecloth, we now use a paint strainer. This is a $2.19 nylon paint strainer from Sherwin-Williams. And for straining fruit and making juices, this is the bomb because you don't get that icky fibers of the cheesecloth. It's very much cheaper. It's reusable. You just rinse it out and dry it. It's a 5-gallon size. It's got elastic on the top. And I'm putting it here over a colander. So in the process, say, of making service berry juice or making a berry juice or a grape juice, this is going to be part of that process. I'm going to run it through there. This looks discolored. This has gotten so many batches of berry juice, it's just kind of turned. But this is another helpful size of strainer. Large bowls, and I'll talk about this a little bit later, very useful for collecting juices and also for washing the produce. My champion large bowl. And this I found in Madison County in Hot Springs, North Carolina at the hardware store. This is my favorite thing for washing off batches of vegetables, fruits, things to can. You have to be very gentle in handling the produce, and we'll go through that during the second half. Now, a couple of these big items here. Or a Dutch oven. This is a heavy cook pot, very heavy. It's enameled. You could also use stainless steel. I love the Dutch oven that's enameled because you can't really burn or scorch things easily. So when you're working with fruits, it's nice to know that that's not gonna do. So this is the type of thing you're going to use to prepare the contents to put into the jars.
How many quarts is that?
No idea. It's probably, what, 2 gallons?
Yeah.
This was a loaner from... Big. Big and heavy. Big and heavy, but a Dutch oven or something, again, anything but aluminum. And I really don't know anybody who uses copper. This is perfect. And this, you notice this one sitting here somewhere along the line, I lost the top. This is from the restaurant supply store in downtown Asheville, and the restaurant supply place is great to get big pieces of equipment. This is just a marked storage, restaurant quality, food quality, and it'll tell you exactly how much you have. So let's say you're making a berry juice. it sits overnight so that the sediment can fall to the bottom. This is a perfect thing. You can put it in the refrigerator, let it sit, and you can also tell exactly how many of each type of jar you're going to need in order to make your batches up. So this is handy, and it was really inexpensive. Asian food stores often have also large bowls, strainers, and that type of thing at very modest cost. So don't want to melt that one by accident. And this is the water bath. And these are sold separately as the water bath canner. You're going to find these at a hardware store, a variety store, online. It's got, as you see, ridges on the bottom. It's got a rack in here. And this allows you to place the jars in here and have the water circulate freely all the way through. This can be aluminum because the food is never going to touch this directly. This model itself is aluminum with enamel covering on it. I also have a bigger one that's just plain old aluminum. So the water bath is made out of a lightweight material because if you fill this up with water, it's suddenly very difficult to move. And if it were a heavier metal, it would be almost impossible. So the water bath, I priced them today at Ace or $25 or under. This is to boil water and to have it circulate. So let me make a little warning here. If anybody has a glass top stove, you cannot do canning on that. There are a couple of reasons.
Well, see you.
Well, bye. But I thought I might as well tell you now what can happen. Let me see if I can remember, because we did check on this. It can get so hot. There's a lot of heat generated while you're processing. It can trip the high temperature control and everything shuts down. It can the heat can crack the top, and that's a $500 or more replacement item. You don't want that to happen. And finally, if you have any irregularities, if you have any dents, if you're using a water bath that's dented, or you can get not a good fit on the glass plate itself so that you don't get the circulation. So if you have a glass top stove, you have to either set up one of those turkey boiler things. You can do it outdoors on a propane. That's fine, but you just really can't do it on a glass top. So you have to go to plan B if that's the case. Finally, we've got...
But we can use like an Esca turkey roaster.
Yes, right? You could use a turkey roaster for sure. And it actually is faster because I think it gets the temperature up higher. My co-author on Drink the Harvest, she did all her canning outdoors in a turkey roaster, and it was really fast and also didn't get the kitchen quite so hot. Some people have canning kitchens outside. That works too. You're going to need in the process a tea towel, possibly some paper towels, a clean tea towel, because as you put the bands and lids on, one of the steps is going to be to wipe that so that there's nothing that can prevent the seal from forming. So that's equipment. Any questions on that? What you need for the equipment? Most of this stuff you're going to have around the house, or a friend can have it. And let me say, really the hardest thing about canning is making it happen, picking a day and sticking with it. When your harvest is at the peak, that's when you have to do the processing. You can't say, well, I'll do it next week, or I'll pick the stuff today and I'll do it in a couple of days. It's really great to have a friend, a cooking buddy, somebody you can say, hey, today's the day, let's go ahead and do this. It's nice to have a friend too, because I think between two people, you always have enough brains to get through the process. All right, I'll show you some contents, and then we're gonna do sort of a dry run through of what we would do if we were making pickles, which you're all gonna rush home and make pickles, I know. All right. Fresh produce, we'll get to that in a minute. Some of the ancillary things you need are a little bit of sugar does improve the flavor of the juices. And the reason I do so many fruit juices is if you do jellies or jams, which are how a lot of people start with their canning, it's so much sugar. Sugar actually is a preservative. And that's part of the gel process, is jellies stay good a long time because the sugar displaces water or something like that. Yeah, so there's actually, you know, you've got sugar-cured ham, sugar-cured this, sugar-cured that, candied fruit peels, it's sugar. So this does have a preservative property, you don't have to use much, but some recipes call for a little sugar. And in fact, the watermelon rind pickle is a sweet and sour, so that's got a fair amount of sugar. You can make syrups with sugar, but nothing fancy. You're going to get the cleanest flavor, but yes, you can use other kinds of sweeteners. I'm not sure about the effects of honey. You'd want to check that with the Blue Book. Some recipes call for a little bit of salt. I don't know why I even put this in here, just because I had the sugar, the salt, everything else. Lemon juice. Often you're going to have recipes that call for some lemon juice. Don't use fresh citrus. Use a real lemon product, or this is the Harris Teeter house brand. The Ingles house brand is called Real Laura. Mm-hmm. It's all the same, but the reason you want to use this and not homegrown fruit or fruit from the store is you have no way to gauge the acidic content of the fruit itself, whereas this has been a guaranteed acid level. So this is safe. This is guaranteed to have the requisite acidity. Okay, so always just opt for the liquid stuff. Same thing with the vinegar. You don't really want to use your vinegar that you've made at home necessarily, or an artisan vinegar. You want to get something that says 5% acidity. And when you go to the grocery store, this is the white vinegar. You can get apple cider vinegar that's a little darker. If you want to keep the color really pure, you would use the clear. But anything for a pickle, this is what provides the protection, the acid for the pickle. That's why you can put a low acid vegetable like a cucumber into a jar and it's safe, because you're basically floating it in vinegar. So use the store-bought vinegar. Don't fool around. It's got the right acid. Now, in order to keep the colors fresh on the fruits and vegetables that you've done, this is citric acid, and you buy it at the same place at the grocery store, the hardware store, that your canning supplies. It is just vitamin C. I don't know how they make it. There's nothing nefarious about it. It protects against browning. It will keep the color fresh and look nice. Why is that important? Because if you have something in a jar and it's been there for a year or so, and the color is starting to go a little brown or fade, it's not going to look as appetizing, and you might not consume it. It's just going to sit there. So this is actually going to make it more attractive. This is from last year. The color is still pretty nice. If I opened it up, it would be a nice grapey color. There's just a little bit of this. And the recipes are generally going to say you put a teaspoon in or half a teaspoon, depending on the size of the jar. And I use these interchangeably. One says fresh fruit produce protector, and the other says citric acid for home canning. I don't think it matters. And I just put that in each jar as I fill it. So you don't put this in necessarily to what you're cooking, but you're going to put it in. Now, everybody got a packet of this, a pickle, either a bread and butter pickle, or a dill pickle. A couple of you might have a salsa. Same thing, it's all from the canning section of the grocery store. And these kits are fine. These are a little, it's like they've done the mixing for you. You can add whatever you want. This has got the recipe. It tells you how much vinegar to put in. It tells you how much sugar to put in. It tells you how much produce to put in, how many jars you're going to get. So it's great if you're just starting out in canning. You can take this and feel really confident that you're going to get a good product. Now, added to that, that's why I gave everybody a head of garlic. If you're making a pickle, you can put garlic in, you can put homegrown dill in, you can put fennel in, you can put a bay leaf in, you can put tarragon in. These are things I brought from my garden, and some of them are pretty floppy, but you can put those things in and enhance a plain pickle. So if you're just starting in canning, this is a way you can feel really safe. You're going to be using vinegar, sugar, nothing can go wrong. The instructions are on here. It tells you how long to cook it, et cetera, et cetera. If you have done some canning, this is a starting point, and you can then add more things and add different foods and just do whatever you like, as long as you're following the basic rules. Now, as the years have gone by and I've done more and more of these fruit juices, I start adding my own little touches. It's like people that have their signature. So I've got a couple things that I usually toss in. This is just from the Asian food store in Asheville, and these packets of ginger tea. It's a little bit of granulated sugar with ginger flavoring. So to make the fruit juices more interesting, like service berry juice, I might put some of this in as it's cooking or after it's cooking and it's straining through, just to give it a nice little flavor. The other thing I like to put into just about everything is a cinnamon stick while it's dripping through. Gives it a nice little flavor. So you can create your own things. I grow a lot of herbs. These are my own coriander seeds. So in a pickle, they've put in the coriander seeds for you, but you can make your own, do your own herbs and add more of those. I grow garlic. This one's from downstairs here, but I'm pretending it's mine. So you can put your, if you're making dilly beans, you can put your own extras in. As I mentioned, the dill. If you're making dill pickles, dilly beans, okra and dill, and you can get dill to grow better than I can, go for it. These are red hot pepper flakes that I made from hot peppers that I grow, cayenne peppers. When they're all done, I dry them in the dehydrator. Then I run them through the blender for a couple of seconds, and voila, really super hot. So for a nice spicy pickle, I'm going to add some of my hot peppers in too. So it's a really nice way to add your own homegrown produce to the product. Huge garlic crop this year, too much, and I at one point was cutting off garlic scapes, and I don't know if any of you have gotten into using garlic scapes, but why the heck not put some garlic scapes into your pickle? If you like a really garlicky pickle, these are very garlicky. So these are just dried. I put them on the porch and left them, and now they dried nicely, so those scapes are available to use. And I brought a couple of things. I don't know if any of you go to the WNC Farmers Market, the great big one, but that's where I find the freshest food. So we're going to go into the pickle making process in just a second, but I want to talk about the freshness and the uniformity. So yesterday morning at 10 a.m. I went over to the WNC Farmers Market looking for the best pickling cucumbers. If you have a great big yard and you like growing cucumbers and you can grow flawless cucumbers, and a bunch of them come in right at the same day, you're excellent. You're doing great. I can't, and I don't like growing cukes because they're just such a low success, and I have a tiny yard. So I buy the cukes, then I add a lot of my own herbs, my own garlic, and all that type of thing in. So what we're looking for, let's pretend we're going to make some dill pickles out of the dill pickle package, is uniform size, very small, tight. These are a day old, and they're already past it. So yesterday I went in at 10 a.m., went looking for the prettiest cucumbers I could get, found this bunch.
So this is already past.
I would say that's past, because it's getting a little spongy. Uh-huh. What you want is absolutely the freshest. These, and I asked the lady, where are these from? She said, oh, these are picked in Candler this morning. So they were picked at 5 or 6 a.m. yesterday, and they were at the WNC Farmers Market. If I had been making pickles, I would have taken these right home, and between 5 a.m. when they were picked and noon, I would have used those, and they were still wet with the dew. So these, you know, your produce, once you pick it, the freshness starts falling away right away. So that's why I emphasize, when you're ready to pickle, get all your equipment together beforehand. Buy your jars, buy your lids, have your utensils, have all the ingredients that you need at hand, and when you decide it's the day to make pickles, the very last thing you're going to do is to go and either pick your own fabulous, perfect pickles, or you're going to go somewhere and get really fresh. So you're not going to want the great big cucumbers from the salad-sized cucumbers. These are pickling cucumbers. So you can either cut these into spears, you know, whatever kind of pickle shape you like, or you can chop them across into the little, you know, the bread and butter, the little crossways pickle or for the hamburger pickle. So those can be cut up any way you like, and you can leave them whole, you can do them in half, you can do them any shape you want. I brought some okra along to give you another idea. This is not fresh. The guy gave this to me because it was beyond selling, but I wanted to just remind you that you can take okra. If you have okra coming into your yard, do the whole pickle thing with okra. You can do the whole pickle thing with hot peppers, as I showed earlier. You can do the whole hot pickle thing with green beans and make dilly beans, which is wonderful. If you like beets, you can do same thing with beets. So no matter what your product is, the process is going to be the same. Okay, so now we're going to take a breath. I'm going to pretend that it's time to make pickles. We're not really going to do it because, partly for the time involved in bringing everything up to the boil, the washing of everything, but other, more important, is that when you get done with a batch of canning, you're going to have some very, very hot jars that need to just sit for 12 to 24 hours. Once they've been in here boiling for half an hour and you take them out, the contents are hot, the jars are hot, everything's hot, and the glass is actually a little bit, you know, not gelled or unstable, but it really just needs to cool back down. It's tempered glass and it needs to cool down. So the end product, that's why I'm doing it as a dry run. We're just going to do everything but the actual cooking. So the first step would be to have a supply of jars. Now, when you're doing a batch, you should have the same size for your entire batch. So this canning bath will hold 7 or 8 quarts, or 7 or 8 or 9 pints. So you want to do one batch with a uniform size so that you get everything cooking at a uniform rate, uniform temperature. You don't want to mix the little tiny jars with a half-gallon jar. It just doesn't work. Very important in the canning, I'll pretend that we're going to sterilize everything in a second, but the main thing you have to keep in mind is everything has to come up to a high temperature at the same time. You're going to heat your vinegar. The only thing you don't heat is going to be the cucumbers, the garlic, and the herbs. But your liquid that you're going to use has got to be heated. The jars have got to be heated. Then you fill the hot jars with the hot liquid, put it into your hot water bath, crank it up, and get it to boil. If you don't bring everything up at the same time, that's when you run the risk of cracking a jar. Because it's thermal shock. The inside might be cold, the outside's hot, the atoms are expanding at different rates. I'm not sure I've ever had a jar break. I've done probably 1,000 or 2,000 jars of this and that. As long as you bring your contents up to heat, your jars are up to hot, and your water bath is up to hot, that's gonna make sure that you're not gonna crack your jars or have a dangerous spill of any kind. Okay, so the main thing is bring everything up to temperature at the same time. That means I want to have some scalding water. If I were doing this at home, I would have the scalding water on the back. I would have the water bath probably on the biggest burner because it's got to get really high heat. I would probably have a plate right here, and everything's going to be kind of coming together in temperature at the same time. I'm going to put scalding water here and just keep it on the very, very lowest temperature. So everything you're going to wash first, let's say we're going to do a bunch of pints. We've got to have 8-pint jars, you're going to have 8 rings, you're going to have 8 lids, and your various things that you want to have. Get the scalding water and just have those aside. I don't have a dishwasher. But people who have a dishwasher, you can certainly put your jars through the dishwasher and just hold them in a dishwasher while you're getting everything up to speed. Because that'll keep it hot and they'll be sterile. So what I do is I wash all my stuff in hot water, and then I actually go ahead and fill this with the water bath with water, and as each one gets done, I just kind of hold it on a simmer. So while I'm working with everything else, once I've got my jars clean, I'm going to put them into the warm water, the hot water, and the water bath, not filled, just empty, just to keep them at a nice hot temperature so that they're sterile. Meanwhile, I'm going to read the instructions on the back of the dill pickle packet. I'm going to pour in however much vinegar it says. I'd put the sugar in, I'd put the packet of spices in, and I'd do whatever it says here. I would turn this Dutch oven on a medium heat get that up. And generally, whatever it is you're working with, whether it's a tomato sauce, or there's a great recipe for Bloody Mary mixer, which has got about 101 homegrown ingredients in Drink the Harvest. Anything you're going to put into the cans, that's what you do while this stuff is kind of staying warm. You're going to mix together your ingredient, or you're going to take your juices that you strained the night before. You're going to take, ladle out the clear juice on top. Anything that you're going to fill the cans with, the jars with, will go in the Dutch oven. Turn the heat up to medium. So everything now is in medium. We've mixed up our pickle liquid. That's starting to get to the, what I like is that place where it just starts to have a little bit of smoke. It's not boiling, it's not even bubbling. It's just starting to get hot enough that it's got a little bit of vapor on it. Perfect. Same thing here. When I do any canning, whatever the contents are of this, I use a filtered water. That way, if you're on city water, you don't get the chlorine taste, you don't get a metal taste. It's a nice, clean flavor. For your canning, water bath, doesn't matter. That can be tap water. So I'm going to have this with eight, let's say it's eight jars. They're going to be eight empty, clean jars in the bath. I'm going to have water up to cover them. They're going to be pretty warm, getting hot, lots of bubbles. All we have to do at that point, this will be a nice scalding water. So I'm going to lift this jar out, empty that hot water back into here, put it on the plate, stick that back in there. The Dutch oven is here. Okay, let's say that we have gotten these pickles from the farmer's market. The step that I didn't do yet would be to put them in a large basin of water and just clean them that way. You really have to handle your fruits and vegetables very, very carefully, especially berries, anything that's going to bruise and start to spoil. I would float them, lift them out, strain them. Then, before I do this step, I'm going to put in maybe a little bit of that citric acid. The pickles are all nice and cut. Let's say we're going to have a mixed pickle. I'm going to put a couple of hot peppers in there. I'm going to put a garlic scape in there. Then, so the jar is still hot. Once those jars get hot, they stay pretty hot. That glass is thick. At that point, I'm going to put the wide mouth thing and go glug, 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 glug. It's going to fill, but not all the way to the top. Every recipe is going to give you a head space. And depending on the size of the jar and what the contents are, the recipe will say probably either a quarter inch, a half inch. That is what allows the vacuum seal to form. You don't fill it up to the top. If the very few times that I've had a seal not work, it's usually because I filled it too high. You actually have to leave this because that air has to come out. So you filled it up to the required head space. Let's say it's a half an inch, and I think that's the bottom one. You're going to wipe this top off with either a paper towel to make sure there's nothing on here to impede the seal. Put the lid on and then put a ring. Of course, I won't be holding it because I've just put scalding hot vinegar into it. But you're going to do this, and now here's the other very, very important thing to get a seal. You don't squeeze it tight. You only squeeze it till it catches. And the reason is, if you squeeze it tight, there's nowhere for that air to escape, and it won't set a seal. So you really have to make yourself not tighten that all the way. It's just to tighten it enough to hold it in place. Water is not going to leak in during the water bath process. So that is the top reason for a failure to seal is this has just simply been too tight. Okay, so we've got a hot jar filled with fresh pickles, lots of herbs, spices, and that hot vinegar mix with the pickle. We put it back in with the big tongs and repeat the process. Meanwhile, I'm cranking up the temperature. Now it's filled, everything is resting on that rack. There's an inch above the jars of water. You turn it up, and in the higher the altitude, the longer it's going to take to get to the boil, and you really have to pay attention to cooking times anywhere over, I think, 1,500 feet. All the charts, all the recipes are going to tell you where the high altitudes. You have to cook it longer. You have to get it in that water bath longer in order to get the temperature up because of the air pressure. Okay, so then I've got it nice and filled up. Put the top on, crank it up, check it, and when it is at the boil, put that top on and put the timer on. And then generally, I'll be honest, I just put everything on for 25 or 30 minutes. It'll tell you 15 minutes maybe for this size or 20 minutes for the other size. We're at high altitude right at the cutoff. You can't overcook any of this stuff. So I just, once it gets rolling, I'll usually put it on for 25 minutes and clean up the kitchen. Okay, bing, timer just went off. Now, I'm gonna have a good place to put these hot jars. And that's gonna be a cutting board, usually a cutting board covered with a tea towel or a couple of towels on a countertop. Don't put these hot jars on your expensive marble countertop because that would be really sad to crack it. So you want to buffer that. You're going to put something down, turn off the heat, take out each jar individually, place it down there, and you want to have enough space so that each jar has got an inch or a half an inch of space so that they can cool gradually. You're going to take those all out, and usually within a couple of minutes, if not seconds, you're going to hear this wonderful sound that goes, and that's the seal forming. The hot air boiled out, I mean, the air was forced out during the bath, the water bath. You take it out, it cools, and it pulls down that top. At the time that you hear that top, the ring is superfluous. So you leave this, just leave the rings, leave everything. And I know one lady who covers it with a towel and leaves it overnight and never looks. I just have to look because it's so pretty. And then, so the next day you go out in the morning, the rings will be loose, you take the rings off. Why? Why don't you leave the rings on? Because you don't want to let any moisture, a mold form under there that could contaminate your product. There is no need for that. Once you've got that vacuum seal, you don't need it.
And my neighbor gave me a jar of green beans that just had that on it, and I thought, well, that's strange, because I'd never seen one with just
right.
That.
So you don't want to store them with the rings on, because if you've got them. Now, they need to cool down for 12 to 24 hours before you really do anything. During that time, I'll take the Sharpie and mark what it is. And then you want to store this stuff not in a basement where there's moisture. You don't want any potential for mold to form around the edge of that jar. A closet, a cupboard, someplace that's going to have a stable temperature, moderate temperature, not a lot of swings. And you don't want to put it in the window, even though it's very pretty, because you don't want the sunlight to degrade the color and the quality of the thing. That's it. Then you've got it. And you're done with your process. So, questions. What do you do, for example, if you don't get a seal? Let's say you did 20 jars of something. Then that's what I'm going to do probably in 2 weeks. I'll do my whole year's worth of tomato sauce. You might get one that doesn't seal. If you get one that doesn't seal, simply use that jar first. Nothing's wrong with it. It's just not shelf stable. You just use the ring. Let's say this one, and mostly 99% of the time, they're fine. They're going to seal. But if you have one that doesn't seal, put the ring on it, stick it in the fridge. That's the one you use first. It's just like a jar of jelly or olives or anything else. Once it's opened, you store it in the fridge. All the other ones can be stored at room temperature. If you get 5 or 6 or 7, something's wrong. If you get a bunch of them that don't seal, something's wrong with your process. And you can do two things. You can store them all in the fridge, or you can put them all back in the pan and do the whole process over again. It's very rare for that to happen. If you're following all the steps and all the rules, generally you're going to have everything's going to seal.
You use new lids?
Yes, thank you for that reminder. If you have to reprocess the batch, you're going to have to put the new lids on because that seal is no longer going to have 100% integrity. If something's happened, you know if it's wrong. If you happen to have one jar that's got mold or it's bulging or it's fizzy, or don't use it. Put the entire thing in the trash, jar and all. Put it in a plastic bag, put it in the trash, there's no problem. You'll know it if there's nothing, you know, if it looks fine, it is fine. If you've sterilized it and you've got that vacuum seal. Okay, other questions?
With low acid foods, can you pretty much do any of those as like a vinegar pickle? So like an egg or
carrots? I would think so. The question was, if you want to take any of the low acid vegetables, instead of canning them on a pressure canner by themselves, can you put them into a pickle form? Yes. Check the blue book, get some guidance on what's the recipe. And they'll tell you if you want to make up your own recipe. You don't have to have this. I stole this from somebody. You can have it back. So that's just an easy starting point, but you can buy pickling salt separately at the grocery store. It's a salt that's going to not have any side effects as far as sediment or anything. It's just specially ground for pickling. And so you can make your own mixes, or you can start with this and just go for it. Yes.
How about eliminating air bubbles in the jar?
Yes. Thank you for reminding me about that. If you've got something chunky like applesauce or a thick sauce, not a bad idea. Before you put the lid on, put the band on and put it in, be sure to run a knife or a spatula down there or give it a tap to make sure that the air bubbles don't form. That's going to give you better sealing. Yes?
I've heard a lot of people say they like to drink the pickle juice after they finish the pickles.
Yeah.
So that's... This is okay?
Yeah. I like that. That stuff's good. Yeah, my husband just did a batch of these today, so I was really impressed. He went through all the steps and he did that. And of course, we didn't can them because we just put them in the fridge and give them away. But actually, they'll sort of seal themselves if you get enough heat in there. But it's really, you know, we're still going to put those in the fridge. Other questions?
Yeah, I don't know if I've heard, but how high does that water go? In the bath?
The water's going to need to be 1 inch over the top of the jar. So depending on the size of the jar, different water level. So I usually get everything started cooking at the same time and it all comes together nicely. And once you've got that together, you have time to clean out your pots and pans or your utensils and get everything ready.
So would you fill this like halfway up to start off with water? Because you're not going to keep adding. Mm-hmm. If you're going to fill it with quart jars,
you're going to have too much in there.
You'll have too much if you have half.
What I would do with quart jars or anything else, I'm going to start with these full of water. I'm going to fill them at the tap with hot water and lower them into the warm water. And if at the point, I'll just keep emptying them here up to the point at which it gets ridiculous because there is going to be displacement. But while I'm getting everything hot, I'm going to want those jars to at least be up to the top so that they get uniformly hot. You want to really respect that glass.
If you're doing the small jars, can you stack them?
No, I wouldn't advise stacking them. Yeah, you want to have that water circulate all the way, and if you have them stacked up on top of each other, so that's not recommended. I would say, if you have less than about half a gallon of material, it's kind of not worth it to go through this. If you've only got two little jars worth of produce, just put them in the fridge. If you've got a half a gallon or a gallon or 2 gallons, go ahead and spend half the day and get it all done. So,
if you had two racks though, could you stack those on top of each other and process?
You're going to have to look into that, whether there's a double rack. Now, there is a system using a steamer container, and I've never used that. It's a little bit more hazardous with kids. You have to watch it every minute so it doesn't run out, but apparently it pasteurizes. It does two steps in one, and some people like those a lot. It's also much more expensive, so I like the stuff that is really easy to acquire it for low cost, keep it in good shape, and you're just going to have it for years and years. So the longer you have all your canning equipment, of course, the unit cost of every jar goes down, and the more you grow by yourself, it approaches at one point it approaches zero. So it's wonderful to have homegrown grapes in a grape juice that you just can't buy anything that delicious at a store. So So I'm really into the juices a lot, the tomato sauce, but whatever you use, whatever you like to eat, that's what you should be doing with your canning.
Well, honey, how long is it going to take to offset the cost of my new stove?
Thank you. That's exactly what I'm thinking.
We don't have that much time.
Okay, that I think that covers what I wanted to make sure that we cover today. Remove the band, store in a cupboard, shelf life. And then, as I said, there's a worksheet on the back. So just make an honest assessment of either what you really want to eat or what you've got a lot of. And there is a storage component. If you are in a small apartment or a very tiny house, you may not have a lot of storage room for a lot of cans. And so as I've downsized in my own life, that's really been something I've had to downsize a little bit, the what I call the can pantry. But I'm concentrating on the things I like the best and what the family likes the best. So once you get into doing this yourself, you're just going to love the flavor and the originality. And it's your produce, and of course it looks beautiful, and it's there on a rainy day or a snowy day when you don't really want to go out. Yes, ma'am.
Storage, you mentioned, you know, not in an area that would be damp and stuff like that. We have an area underneath our steps, but it's on the lower floor, like in the basement. And it's like a closet underneath the steps, and that's what I had in mind, but I don't know how that would...
If you have a place and it doesn't get mildewy, you're probably okay. If you've got a basement that gets mildewy, no, it's too damp. But what you might want to do is to put some shelving so that it's up off the floor. Just put a wooden, you know, like two bricks and a shelf just to keep it up a little bit. Uh-huh. And don't store your jars in two... Don't stack those jars either, because you don't want to compromise the seal with the weight. It's very rare that anything but happened, but it's just not recommended. So go look at some of those websites too. If you're just beginning at this, go check those two or three top websites on that page, because those will show you that any of the answers you've got, or any of the questions you've got that come up in the middle of the process, the answers are probably going to be there. So I'll show you real quick the method I use for berry juices, in case you're interested. I make up this stack. I have a regular colander. I put the paint strainer, and then I put, and sometimes I'll actually put another little bowl up here so that sitting up above here, like I'll put a china cereal bowl under this. So this, I've cooked it, and the recipes are all in Drink the Harvest, and some of them are in Eat Your Yard. So let's say I had 2 gallons of a berry glop. I've put the berries in, I've cooked them, simmered them for 15 minutes, they've broken apart, they've given up their liquid. I will then take the spoon and spoon it into here and let it just sit overnight. I'll stick a cinnamon, stick a cinnamon in the side, and I might put a little of the ginger, or you can put a little piece of slice of fresh ginger, and overnight it will drip, 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 drip. It's a gravity feed. Don't ever squeeze. Don't ever squeeze this, because what happens is you'll get all the pectin. Let's say this is full of 5 gallons of berry mash, and you've let it drip, 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 and you think, oh, I'm going to get every last drop, I'll squeeze it. You're going to get it cloudy. The pectin, you will squeeze the pectin through and you'll make it cloudy. So that's why I say it just drips down, then I'll let it sit, and if I have an extra day or I don't have time to do the canning, I'll actually put it in that square measuring thing. But I'll ladle it off the top. So what happens is some of the solids will precipitate and they'll go down to the bottom. You very gently ladle that clear, and that's where you get your really top quality clear juices, is you're taking that clear juice off the top, putting it in here, and your sediment remains here. Get rid of that. Or make a balsamic out of it. And then you've got your clear juice, your sediments left over, you deal with that. And then whatever's in here, put it in the compost, feed it to the chickens, feed it to the pigs, whatever your thing that you do at your house is. Some people will put this in the dehydrator on a special tray and make a fruit leather. So you can have a second life for the mash. You could put it as a beer flavoring, whatever you want to do. Okay, I think that's it. I would be happy to take any of the questions. We've got books back there, and if you want to take a look at any of this equipment up close, you're welcome to do that. So thank you very much for all your time. I promised myself I was going to retire. This may be my last demonstration ever. But we'll see. We'll see. This has been a real pleasure, and I hope all of you will get started on this real soon. Thanks.